Good morning from Miami Beach. This is Dr. John Bennett broadcasting for Neurosurgical TV. We have another episode in the Daily Dose of Neurosurgery Education, headed by Ed Cherian. Today we have another presentation by Jody Parthaban, a neurosurgeon from India. And I'll just let him take over. And welcome, Jody, and it's all yours.
Hi. Hey, it's nice. Good evening and good morning to friends. Are you able to see my slides?
Yes. You want to make it bigger? Or?
I'll make it, yeah.
Okay. There you go.
Is that okay?
Yeah, perfect.
Right. It's nice to meet you again today. This week, I like to take you through a new approach as a, you know, retropharyngeal approach to the upper cervical spine. Last week, we saw subaxial spine. Now, this time, we'd like to focus on the upper cervical spine. So, reaching upper cervical spine is a very interesting subject, but at the same time, you need more understanding about some of the simple anatomy over there. Now, this approach is not a new one. It is a very old approach, right? Initially, it was defined by Stevenson's as parapharyngeal approach, which is a T incision in the neck, T incision. It was done in 1966. And later on, it is by Whiteside and Kelly in 1966 again with Verbeest. They call that as lateral cervical retrocarotid. Retrocarotid means posterior to the carotid, that means lateral to the carotids. So that was another approach. And Riley in 1973 again described similar approaches to the upper cervical spine. However, the transcervical retropharyngeal approach, what we do now, was earlier defined by McAfee, Robinson, and Southwick. There are small adjustments, small changes, but apart from that, the basic is the same. Like last time I told you, the deep cervical fascia has to be divided in such a way we can reach the prevertebral region. Now you can see in this picture, the upper cervical spine is coming more or less parallel to the mandible, the angle of the mandible. When the neck is extended and you make the mandible to go away, then you can reach the upper cervical spine easy. The easiest cervical spine that you can reach at any time is C4, C5, and C6. But from C3 above, it's a little difficult because you have the jaw and also the pharynx, the larynx. And so you find it a little bit difficult. It looks as if it's difficult, but it is not so. It is very, very simple. So reaching the C1, C2, C3 becomes more important because a lot of diseases come at that region. So we need to know the approach. This picture you can see the upper cervical spine, that is C1, C2, can be approached through a transoral approach. In the midline, you can see there is, in the middle, you can see a picture of the skull where the jaw is open. You can see C2 and C1. This is our classical transoral approach. But if you extend the mandible, the right side, you can see the picture which shows the needle is pointing up to C2 vertebral body. So that means that by extending very nicely and keeping the incision far above, compared to the subaxial cervical spine incisions, you can reach those areas very nicely, though it is deep. Now the gray line, the gray area zone, you can see on the left side, it shows that you can reach from the lower aspect of the clivus, C1, C2, and C3. And if you extend it, then you can even go for C4 and C5. So up to this region, you can approach through the retropharyngeal approach. Now, this is the classical incision types. You can see C4, C5 is very quiet comparatively up the thyroid cortex, where you can easily palpate. And C3 is slightly above, is the heart. And C1, C2, for C1, C2, it is submandibular. So you have to know about understanding, but it may not be the same, because in a thick neck, these things will change. So this is for a normal, a thin anatomy, normal anatomy. Now on the right side, you can see the diagrammatic approach of the retropharyngeal cervical approach, anterolateral cervical approach. Now I'll go through, take you by step by step. And you can see in this picture, the patient is anesthetized, positioned, and the neck is well extended. You can have a look at the incision. The incision is slightly lower, then lower to the mandibular border. The anterior retro or the extrapharyngeal approach is an excellent route to address the upper cervical spine pathologies. The lower part of the clivus, C1, C2, and C3 vertebral bodies, and the D-space, at the D-space and C1, C2 facet joints can easily be exposed in this approach. It is easy in thin built and long necks. Though it looks deep and tunnel-like, a good dissection can make the visibility better, especially with microscope. I'll show you by steps. Now you can see the position of the patient. This patient can be positioned nicely, and you can take a C-arm picture and keep it for your reference. The anesthetized patient is positioned supine and the neck is well extended. The chin is turned to the opposite side by 30 degrees and the head rests on over a ring. The rotation of the mandible to the left side provides a free access to the upper cervical spine. This is very important to achieve a clear vision over the field, and the microscope can easily be angled during entire surgery. Skull tongs will help you in trauma patients to facilitate traction or usually immobilize the patient while surgical procedure. Fluoroscopic images can be obtained to assess and to see the details of C1 and C2 alignment with localization of the target area. Whatever you want, you can reach the full extent of clivus to C3. The skin incision is marked 1.5 to 2 centimeter below the mandible from chin to angle parallel to the inferior margin. At both ends, the skin incision can be extended. You can see the marking very nicely. This is a very classical marking of submandibular mark for the retropharyngeal approach. And one has to, once you open it, open the subcuticular, subcutaneous area, you find you may be having a lot of fat. You have to expose the platysma. Now here the dissection is just like a cadaver dissection. You cannot limit the dissection. The dissection must be very good. The skin is incised and the subcutaneous dissection done widely on both sides so that the exposed area is large. The platysma is visualized and meticulous dissection is ensured. Stay sutures are placed at subcutaneous layer and the surgical area is kept very wide. No need to get worried why so much of wide, but only when you make such a wide incision, you can reach your target. After that, the platysma is lifted up. The platysma muscle is first split from the mandibular symphysis to the median notch of the superior thyroid cartilage. The subplatysma dissection is done very, very meticulously, and the muscle is cut horizontal to the entire breadth of the surgical exposure. The cut edges of the platysma are then everted and placed with stay sutures. This step exposes the deeper structures. This is a very important step. The platysma should be meticulously cut. Now you can see, the moment you expose the platysma, you will find the parietal muscles. You will also find the facial artery. There is no need to ligate the facial artery, though I have shown you there. It is not needed at all. The facial artery comes very, very lateral. So one do not need to disturb that. Further dissection of the deep cervical fascia exposes the pretracheal muscles. The fascia over the submandibular gland. You can see the submandibular gland. Submandibular gland and the facial vessels just posterior and inferior to the gland. You can see the facial artery. The facial vessels need not be cut for exposure. Surgeon can see the groove lateral to the laryngeal cartilage and can palpate the structures gently. The carotid is palpated lateral to this groove. I will just show you this one. You can see this is the groove I was mentioning about. This is the facial artery. It's a facial vessels here. We don't need to go there. Our interest is here. Thyroid will be here. The hyoid will be there. So you have a small area you can see here. And this region you can palpate the carotid artery. This region will have the submandibular gland. Here you will have the submandibular gland. Now, this is the next picture. Now you can see very nicely the submandibular gland is very nicely dissected and exposed. And the gland is exposed. In a few occasions, one can find a very large gland. Sometimes you find a very large gland. It may not be small. Sometimes it will be very, very big, which may need a partial excision. But generally, the gland is preserved. The gland need not be cut. Generally, it is preserved. The inferior end can be lifted to visualize the glistening digastric tendon. I'll show you. Now you can see the, are you able to see the gland there? It has been lifted with an instrument. And in the next picture, you can see with the Langenberg retractor retracting the submandibular gland, you can find the glistening yellow digastric tendon. This digastric tendon is very important to find this digastric tendon because the tendon passes through a facial sling that is attached to the greater wing of hyoid. I'll show you here this region. You can see here, this is a sling. This is the digastric, this is the digastric ligament. You can see that tendon here. And this is the sling and this is a hyoid here. So if you can cut this and this digastric become very loose and it can be retracted up. The reason for that is, when you retract, when you go deeper and deeper, you may need a little bit of more retraction. And that will be facilitated by cutting that sling. The facial sling is attached to the greater wing of hyoid. To facilitate easier retraction of hollow organs, this sling should be cut and the tendon is released. In the next slide, I'll go and show you the next slide. Now you can see very beautifully, the digastric tendon is released. Just below the digastric tendon, you can see the hypoglossal nerve just below the tendon and it runs parallel to it. There is no need to try to dissect it, just leave it. By dissecting the deep cervical fascial layer between the laryngeal cartilage on the medially and the carotids on the laterally, the corridor for the surgical approach is now created. Once you create this, the surgeon can palpate the carotids, the lateral border of the exposure. Now I'm talking about this region, this area. You're able to see this area? Okay, this is the area where we have to focus on. So that's most important. Now you can see here, that is the retropharyngeal. Now you use the Langenberg. The greater cornu of the hyoid is palpated and the superior pharyngeal constrictor muscles are retracted medially. The Langenberg, which you see on the upper side, not on the left side, but on the upper side, maybe on the right side, it retracts the hollow organs and the carotids are laterally placed using right angle retractors. And using the cotton peanuts, as I told you in the subaxial cervical spine approach, the loose areolar tissue are dissected to reach the prevertebral fascia over the upper cervical spine. The dissection is done over the desired area by adjusting the retractors. You have to adjust the retractors in such a way so that you can reach the complete entire anterior aspect of the vertebral body of C3, C2, C1 anterior arch. The pharyngeal muscle is lifted up and retracted superiorly and medially to expose the anterior arch of uterus. So this is the most important aspects that you can see here. And that retractor, the most of the thing is very simple retractors what you use for every cervical spine surgery. These simple retractors can be used, like you can see here in the picture, very nice and anterior instrumentation is done. For superior exposure, the right angle retractor should be long. We should have a long retractors. Narrow beaver's retractors can also be used if you have C1, C2 facetal screws, C1 lateral mass, and C2 body plates and screw fixations. C2, C3 anterior instrumentation and ventral screw fixation of odontoid fractures can be done through this approach. Now, once you master this approach, you can expose from C3 up to lower border of clivus. That's all. But this, you believe me, you do not cut anything. You don't tie any artery. It's just the facial area or tissue you have to dissect very, very meticulously. The exposure must be wide. The dissection must be like what you do for a cadaver dissection. When you do for our basic education, we do a nice cadaver dissection for long incision. So once we do that, this exposure is nice. Now, I will show you some of the case examples, how we have done with this approach. So this is after the surgical procedure is over, you can use simple, that's all. Put back the platysma together and after keeping a pre-vertebral drain, and then you close it. The skin incision is very nice, it comes up. And you believe me that you cannot even appreciate it after a few years that there was an incision because it is below the mandible. Now I'll show you this. What you see on this slide is the operation I did in 1991 and 1992. This is with Anderson type 2 odontoid fracture, and it was operated with the ventral screw fixation. This was done through this approach. Now when we do this approach, we know that we can reach the base of C2 vertebral body, from where you can insert the ventral screw into the odontoid process. This was done with a single C-arm, and was published in 1994 in Neurology India. Probably this is the first case reported in the Indian literature. What is most interesting in this case is that if you carefully look, we have not used any sophisticated screw systems. This is just a malleolar screw system, which is used by the orthopedic surgeons to fix the fractures of the lower limb bones. And the same screw was used in those days. Never had a cannulated screws in those days, but in spite of that, we were able to achieve one of the best results you can achieve with the simplest screws possible. And so this is a very landmark paper, which was published in 1994 and followed by most of the surgeons in India. If I remember correct, there were interesting topic. Myself and Goyal and Romania, we all presented in 1994. We presented in a conference where Professor Goyal also presented a type of fixation of odontoid screw. It was wonderful. We spoke for 3 minutes each in an 8 minute or 9 minute talk. So we divided three speakers in one talk. That's very interesting. Now, similarly, we started using more such cases. We started doing more number of odontoid fractures through this technique. But now we have percutaneous techniques coming. There are, you have a different type of screws, very sophisticated. You use double C arm. And so it becomes more easier and easier. But what I'm trying to say is that Now, every hospital or setup may not have all the facilities. Now, if you don't have the facility, do not get disheartened. Don't think it cannot be done. It can be done. It can be done like this, and you can see the base. You can see the base of C2. Watch here. You can see the base of the C2 vertebral body by yourself, your eyes. You can see. You can come to the center of the C2 vertebral body, nibble it, and guide the screw very nicely into the odontoid process. So, odontoid fracture can be easily done with simple instruments. No need to get worried that I don't have the specialized cannulated screw. I don't have two C arms. There is no need to worry about it. So I think the young surgeons who don't have that kind of facilities do not get disheartened. You can proceed with this retropharyngeal approach. It's such a beautiful approach. Once you open it, you have an exposure of such a large space of cervical spine. Your assistant must be very good. You have to teach your assistant how to retract that pharynx. The pharynx has to be retracted up and medially and also superiorly. So that is enough, because anatomically pharynx will move very nicely up like this, and then up and move it medially. The whole place is exposed to the surgeon. With a microscope, you can see wonderful anatomy. Now, with the same principles, we have done humpty number of hangman fractures. And hangman fractures can be approached anteriorly. Hangman fracture can be approached posteriorly. It does not matter. But here, I have done so many of hangman fracture only through this retropharyngeal approach. So hangman fractures can be operated like this very simply. You can reduce it easily. You can put the interbody grafts and fix the implant. You can see this is the step by step. You can see from the leper up, you can see the mandible, you can see the mandibular gland. Retract the mandibular gland. You can see the sling. Cut the sling. Move very, very medial to the carotid artery. And then you dissect with the aerial. So there you are there. Now you can see the plate. This is very, very simple cervical retractor. There is nothing special there. Absolutely nothing special. A simple retractor is good enough for you to reach and fix the spine. Now, this is a very, very beautiful case. I have to, all these cases are done 20 years ago, my dear friends, I'm telling you. These are not now. This is a doctor. She's a young doctor, a lady doctor, a gynecologist, who had neck pain, found very difficult to bend forward, was not eating well. She was finding difficult to swallow. And when the X-ray was taken, there was a pre-vertebral shadow at the C2, C3, and C2 was collapsing over C3. And the MRI shows such a large retropharyngeal abscess. Can you imagine? You can see a big, big ball there on the left and lower side. It was a big ball. Now, you can see the C3 is posteriorly displaced, and we do not know. Probably this lesion is a pot spine. It's a pot spine, and then we encourage her to undergo for surgery. We use this retropharyngeal approach. In this case, the abscess was opened up, drained completely, carpet degranulation, debridement was done, granulation tissues were removed, anterior cord was decompressed, a grafting for the iliac crest was placed, and a long plate. What plate? You get surprised. And you can see the kind of screws. They are just Evo screws, simple cortical screws, 20 years ago, 25 years ago. Now this patient had recovered very well, and she went back to the work after some time. I don't want her to tell the name of the doctor, but she is one of the very famous doctors now in Kerala. Now you look at this patient. She came to meet me after 20 years. After 20 years, she one day appeared in front. You look at the plate we use is a reconstruction plate, a simple reconstruction plate which was available those days. And even today, the spine is fixed very nice, diffused well. She's doing extremely well. Now, why I am trying to tell is that what you need is a very simple systems, but your exposure should be good. You can do wonderful job. He can do wonderful job. You can see the exposure has given approach up to C4 in this case. Now, we not only use in this kind of cases, now you look here in this C1 and C2 pot spine, we common in India. C1, C2 pot spine common in India. People come with neck pain, torticollis, and usually the recommendation is you wanted to take, confirm the lesion, you want to take the biopsy. Now, either you go from posterior or you go from anterior, sometimes the abscess is very large, you have to drain that. So the routine practice is sometimes you have to go to the transoral approach, then you have to breach the posterior wall of the pharynx. But instead, you can always go through the retropharyngeal approach and evacuate enough of the cold abscess. The patient gets relieved of pain if the joints are not involved. If the joints are involved, probably you may have to fix them or fix them with implants. If it is not so, you just have to reach that area and you can take the biopsy there. Now, this approach you can see on the left and upper corner, the same retractors, nothing, no more special. The cotton ball is now over the lesion. You can see the K wire or wire, whatever is over the lesion. And then you can see the granulation tissue there. Longest fasciculi muscle must be retracted, pushed laterally so that you can find the abscess over there. And once you get the abscess, you can drain it. Now you can see here, this region. The possible, can I show one video now? I'll show one video, maybe.
Sure.
I just try to see how I can get that video. Yeah. John, are you able to see?
Yes.
Yeah, you can see this video now. It shows.
Yes.
That's the retractor. Now that is the longest muscle. I'm pushing the longest muscle on one side. You can see nicely. So the assistant must retract this very nicely. This is the medial retractor, superior and medial retractor. And this is the exposure. And this is the mandibular gland. You can see the mandibular gland. This is the carotids here. Now you can see this is the, probably I think this is C2. Now we go up to C1. The longest muscle must be dissected very nicely. So this approach, now you can see that. See, when you retract more and more, you can see more about it. I'm telling my assistant to push that. Take it up. Yeah, that is very important. So you should keep on driving your assistant. That is most important. So you can use long monopolar cautery to divide the longest musculi, and so that you can reach the C1 and C2 facet region, so that you can expose the, yeah, that is the peanut. With the peanut, you can clean that area. You can see there is something white. You can see here, that's abnormal structures. So once you retract higher and higher, you can reach your pathology. So this is up to C1 and C2 region. So yeah, so I'm just now making a cut over the longest muscle. I'll show you the next video, which will be more clear. Now you can see I've already opened it. Now I'm removing the granulation tissue. Can see that? I'm removing that's a granulation tissue for pot spine. You can remove the granulation tissue as much as possible from that area. You can use the curettes. You can use the punch. You can see that it is coming. Cold abscess will drain from there. Cold abscess, you can see the granulation tissue coming. You can press over the longest musculi. The cold abscess get drained. And by this way, you can, yeah, here you can see that this region. So once you make it one entry, that is good enough. Once you make one entry, it will come very nicely. Watch that. See that? Yeah, it's coming. It's coming nicely. So this is why I'm demonstrating, is just to see the exposure. You can see that nicely. Yeah, good. That's nice. I'll go back to my presentation. So that's the presentation. You can see here, this is the granular scent tissue. You can take it up and C1, C2 cold abscess, which is very common in India and also many Southeast Asian countries and all over the world. So how to take biopsy is the biggest problem. So transoral biopsies are nowadays, maybe you'll get very small tissue. From here, you get a large tissue. If a large abscess can be drained. Now, similarly, and sometimes you may have to excise vertebral body tumors. In this case, you can see one of the tumors. We use the same technique to remove the tumor and then fix with the with anterior plating at C2 and C4. And this sometimes you get into problems with a complex fractures of C1 and C2. Here the C2 vertebral body is smashed in a different fashion. I was a bit worried what to do. So try to fix with mini plates those days. So mini plates, we fixed it so that they get together these pieces, because I find it in flexion. The C2 was falling forward. C1 was also fractured. And then after fixing this, we put Philadelphia collar. Beautiful fusion was there. And look at this kind of fractures. C2 fractured down with C3, flex over, and extrapharyngeal, transpharyngeal, that is extrapharyngeal approach has given us such a beautiful execution of anterior cervical stabilization on this issue. So I like to conclude by saying that retropharyngeal approach is an excellent procedure, excellent approach, which can be used for pathologies from clivus, C1, C2, and C3. I like to recollect one important discussion. I think Goel is there.
Yeah, I believe he is. Dr. Goel, are you there?
Okay, he's not there?
I'll try to get a hold of him.
Okay, he may be coming, right.
Yeah.
I'll try to. So this is my concluding slide. Dr. Goel and myself, we were done in 2000. I think if I remember correct, it was the year 2000.
John, I'm listening to Parthi's comments. Okay, Parthi, go ahead.
Goel, I hope that you remember in Madras, in Chennai, in 2000 Skull Base meeting, we were discussing this matter with Arnold Menezes.
Yeah.
Do you remember?
No, just go ahead. Let me just listen to the
whole thing. Yeah. Arnold Menezes was telling, because I was trying to do a odontoidectomy through this approach. So he was telling that it is very difficult. It is so long. It is deep. It is tunneling, and it is very difficult. But then actually this approach, we can always use it for all this kind of procedures. That time we had an excellent discussion on this matter, and I remember Professor Goel was there, and he was also discussing about this approach. I recollect that memories. Thank you very much for kind listening. Thank you very much.
Okay, very good. Thank you, Dr. Parthiban. Okay, we'll open up immediately for comments or questions. The floor is open. Let me get you off there, Jody. Okay, questions, comments? I can read some, Jody, from the chat. Let me just get a hold of the chat here. Okay, we have a question from Arjun Dar. How did the C1, C2 cold abscess patient present clinically? And did you get a preoperative CT cervical spine and CVJ done?
Yeah. See, generally, C1, C2 tuberculosis patients, they present with neck pain and sometimes with torticollis. Neck pain and torticollis is quite common. And so the patient which you saw at C3, C4 is different, but C1, C2, usually they present with neck pain and torticollis. You always used to take a CT scan. CT scan give a very nice picture whether the joints are also involved, and you can nicely see the how much joint is eroded. I have not gone into the subject. That is a different subject. Maybe in some other time, I can speak on C1, C2 tuberculosis, C1, C2 tuberculosis joints. So most of the cases we do X-rays, CT scans, and MRI altogether. Yeah.
Chandra Mooli asks, do you use traction during the operation?
No, we are not for C1, C2 tuberculosis, but if there is a fracture dislocation, like for example, in Hangman fracture and in the kind of the C3 and C4, we don't use the traction. That means the traction is used only to stabilize the spine. And most of the other thing is done by your surgical technique. But we don't pull too much of traction, no. We try to avoid that.
If someone asks, do we need to cut the digastric tendon?
No, no need to cut the digastric tendon, but you can cut the sling. Once you cut the sling, the digastric tendon moves up. Don't cut the digastric sling, digastric tendon, no.
Can you use instrumentation in TB infections?
Yes, we do. Yes, very much. You can see that. You saw one of the cases, the patient which we have used. Tuberculosis is not contraindication for instrumentation. This doubt was there forever and ever and ever, but it is not so. In tuberculosis spondylitis and tuberculosis, tuberculosis abscess where there is an instability, you can always evacuate the pus, you can degranulate the lesion, you can decompress, and then put an assemble, and then you stabilize this with implants. No problem.
Hey, Dr. Abanoff asks, have you seen implant failure post-anterior fixation surgery?
Oh, very less. I'm very sorry, but I'm very less. In my experience, is very less. I'm talking about a honest one, because the way we learn was very, very gradual. It is very gradual learning. Very, very perfect learning, not in a hurry. So, very less complications, yes.
Okay. Can we turn the patient's head to the contralateral side if we want to perform anterior C1, C2 transarticular fixation?
Yes, you can. You can turn. You have to be very careful when you do C1 and C2 facet screws, but you cannot turn too much also, because sometimes you have a dislocation. So if you have a dislocation, it is very difficult. I have not tried very many cases of C1 and C2 translocation cases through anterior approach. Yeah.
Can you reach into, Dr. Kavanaugh asked, can you reach into a C5 with the same incision?
Yes, you can. But you can, if it is a long incision, maybe sometimes you may need to make a T. That is like a Stevenson's. After the horizontal, you make a slight T so that you can reach it. But many times you can go up to, you saw in one patient, we have reached up to C5.
Would you still fix a C1, C2 POTS today if not having severe myopathy, or go ahead with collar halo and medical management?
Yeah, good question. See, you know, if I have only cold abscess, I drain it out, fix them with Philadelphia collar and give anti-tuberculosis treatment. I fix it only when there is the facet is degenerated, either occiput and C1 or C1 and C2, then I fix it.
Do you prefer expandable cage or iliac bone graft?
I prefer iliac bone graft. Example, this expansible, this is a very tricky job, and it is more a little bit dangerous also. You have to use properly. Otherwise, you know, if it fails, then there will be pharyngeal injuries, very, very significant.
Has there been any incidents of implant subsidence in your case series of anterior cervical surgeries?
Okay, see, implant subsidence comes only when you do standalone techniques. Like we discussed about in my last class, implant subsidence comes very less It mostly usually in implant subsidence comes when you expose the cortical bone, when you decorticate, that is the cartilage is removed. You should not remove too much of cartilage. Then you put any implant, it will subsidence, it will collapse. So you must have some sort of a good cartilage so that the cage holds well. Yeah, so it's a technical matter. It's a technical matter.
Okay, what is the best way to get biopsy sample for culture in case of failure of empirical medical therapy in CVJ POTS?
In CVJ anterior, you're talking about, can you repeat the question, John?
Yeah, what is the best way to get biopsy sample for culture in case of failure of empirical medical therapy?
I'm not able to understand it, but then I like to take a good biopsy for culture. That's why the exposure, because by needle, you don't get enough sample. The yield is less.
If you have to re-explore for some reason, do you go through the same incision?
Okay, yeah, it is a little bit difficult, but you can always approach from the opposite side. Not a problem. Same side, it is very easy, because once you dissect and open, you believe me, even if you open after some time, you have a very good exposure. It will be there. The tunnel will be there, yes.
Okay, Abhidash Haridas asks, from Tampa, asks, I have an asymptomatic C2 odontoid fracture. How much listhesis do you look for in x-ray flex extension, or just watch and wait until symptoms develop?
Okay, you see, the C2 fractures depend on the type, the type of fracture. We don't take much of flexion extension, but we see gauge the type of the fracture. If the fracture is more horizontal, we think it is more susceptible for failure. So we like to fix it. But if the fracture is a little oblique and crosses very close to the vertebral body, we try to avoid surgery. So the angulation, if you ask me, more than 5 millimeters, yes, it is significant.
Okay. Hello, doctor. Go ahead.
Sir, any role of posterior fusion is better than anterior for pot spine, or preferably an anterior will be better? Okay, and if it's cold after the second, what will be the approach?
You're talking about C1, C2?
Yes.
Okay, right. See, we do not know. See, C1, C2 on one side, if you have a facet is involved, and then, and if you wanted to, if you need a fixation, then you can do it from the opposite side, that is on the left side, or if the right side is pathologized, the left side, you can do it. Otherwise, I prefer the posterior approach, because the posterior anatomy is very good and it is very easy. Now, I think Goel is there, and the technique is very simple. Once you start doing it, the technique which he introduced is very, very simple. So you can easily do that from posterior. So anteriorly, you can always take the biopsy if it is anteriorly projecting cold abscess. Posteriorly, that I'm not showing those cases, because here we are just discussing only on the approach, so I just put on the approach. I prefer to do the posterior stabilization.
Okay, for C2 anterior screw, do you prefer always the bicortical purchase?
No, that is the teaching. The bicortical purchase is the teaching, but many times it is difficult. Bicortical purchase is many times difficult. Even if you see my first case, you believe me, there was a gap of 1 to 2 millimeters gap between the fracture site, but over a period of time, there was a fusion. So what it says is that, the teaching of you lag it, bring it closer is good. But then attempting to do that has caused more complications. So what I do is I usually push the screw into the odontoid to the topmost and try to hold it. That's all. It fuses well.
Dr. Abhinav asked, have you seen kinking of the anterior C2 screw?
No kinking. You mean after post fusion?
I'm not sure what he means, doctor. Let me ask him. Dr. Abhinav, are you there? Could you clarify that question? he says, yes, yes, he may be in a bad bandwidth. Posterior fusion, okay.
I'm not getting that.
No. Yeah. Dr. Abhinav, can you ask that question or clarify it in your chat question, please? He's posterior fusion kinking, post-fusion kinking, I think he refers to.
Okay, post-fusion kinking. Yes. Okay, right. That's a good question. So it's in the ventral screw. Sometimes it even get fractured after the fusion. It is a, it's a more of a physiological phenomenon. The forces of fusion, even it fractures the ventral screw. But the odontoid is already fused. So there's no problem, no need to worry about it. I have one patient like that, but nothing will happen to the patient. Yeah. It's already fused. Yeah.
Okay, very good. Dr. Parthaban, I'd like to thank you very much. We're gonna move on to the next.